In this video tutorial, I am going to discuss about the protein folding. I will cover this topic under these three points. The point number one is the protein folding, random or guided. The second point is models of protein folding, and the third point is chaperones. So let's start our discussion with the first point, that is protein folding, whether it is random process or guided process. We want to get the answer of this. So to understand this, let's assume that it's a random process. Protein folding is a random process. Now to understand this, consider this diagram. Okay. So here I had shown you polypeptide chain. This is short polypeptide chain having 50 amino acids. Now this such short polypeptide chains, it is estimated that it can form a millions of different conformation. It can fold into millions of different way and can form a millions of different conformation. So I had here shown you the five different conformation, and here at the last point I had written many million more. Okay, but out of all these different millions of conformation, only one form is going to be the most stable and biologically functional. So suppose this conformation is going to be the most stable and biologically active. So if it is really a random process of protein folding, then what will happen? First, this polypeptide will check it out, this form. Then it will find that this is not most stable one. Then it jumps to its next, of course, randomly. Okay. Then it can jump to the next. Again, it find out that this is not most stable one. So it will keep jumping by the trial and error until it reaches up to its most stable form. Now, to trial and error out all these million different combination, it will require very, very long time. It is estimated that at least some million years are required to reach this short polypeptide to its native conformation, which is very long time. Whereas actually speaking, inside the cell, when such short polypeptide is observed, it is found that such short polypeptide, it folds into its native conformation within milliseconds to seconds. Okay. So what does it mean? It means that protein folding is not random, rather it is well guided and well ordered one. Okay. So here now you can better understand. See, if it is really a random, then it involves exploration of all possible conformations. And as we just talked, this possible conformation can be in the millions, even for the small polypeptide, right? So such exploration requires millions of years to form a native conformation, right? And one fact is that inside the cell, protein folds into their native conformation within the seconds. So this practical aspect is not matching with this above theoretical aspect, right? So what does it suggest? This suggests that the protein folding is not random, but it is more orderly and guided one. So I think that we got our answer that protein folding, whether it is random process or guided process. So of course it is guided process. It is not random process. So now coming to the next point, that is models of protein folding. Okay. Basically there are two different models are suggested for the protein folding. One model is the hierarchical model and the second model is the molten globule model. So let's first discuss about this hierarchical model. Now to understand this hierarchical model, suppose this is the polypeptide chain, this is the N terminal and this is the C terminal. So in the first step of this hierarchical model, what happens? There is first local secondary structure formation. Now what does it mean? It means that instead of this full polypeptide chain undergoing secondary structure formation, only some local parts start making secondary structure, as it is seen in this second diagram. Here you can see this part had formed secondary structure, this part had formed secondary structure, this part and this part had formed secondary structure. That means local secondary structure formation is occurring. In the second step, what will happen? Whatever this local secondary structure is formed, it will now start expanding. Expanding in terms of it takes up this nearby amino acid sequence. Okay. So as you can see in this lower diagram, this short helix is formed long helix. This loop is now involving nearby polypeptide chain to form a beta strands. The same thing with this helix, it is becoming longer and this loop is again making beta strand loop and beta strand. right? So we can say that there is a longer range interactions to form stable super secondary structure. This is the second step. Now here there is a longer range secondary and super secondary structure which are stable one. So in the third step, what will happen? This secondary structure and this secondary structure will further fold. So here you can see alpha helix is folding upon this beta sheet, right? So it is now forming this globule like part. Here also something similar is seen. Here also it is forming globule like part, and both are attached with this flexible portion. So we can call this as a domain 1 and domain 2. This domain 1 and domain 2 may be structurally same or may be structurally different. Okay, that can be anything. But here you can see there is a complete domain formation, right? And we had seen in my earlier video that domain is the structural and functional part of this protein. So now once domains are formed, in the fourth step and fourth and final step, what will happen? There will be a final folding of domains to give rise to this native conformation. So the essence of story in case of hierarchical model is that instead of going this peptide chain all at once under folding, it is occurring in the local part first and then expanding to involve complete polypeptide chain. So that is the hierarchical model. Now let's discuss about this second model, that is molten globule model. Here again I had shown you polypeptide chain. This is N terminal and this is C terminal. We all know that polypeptide chain, it is made up of amino acid, and each amino acid, they have a side chain, and we generally represent this side chain by the R. Now this side chain can be broadly divided into two groups. One is nonpolar and second one is polar. So what I had done in this diagram is that all these R are mentioned for only nonpolar side chain. I had not shown polar side chains. Okay. So this red R is the nonpolar side chain. In the molten globule model, what will happen? All these side chain R which are nonpolar one, they will interact with each other by the hydrophobic interactions. So what will happen? Once this all this nonpolar side chain R interacts with each other, there is this hydrophobic interaction will takes place over here. And because of this hydrophobic interaction, this protein backbone, this amino acid backbone, it folds the three-dimensional arrangement. So we can say that hydrophobic interactions among nonpolar residues, right? This will lead to spontaneous collapse of polypeptide into compact state, which is known as molten globule. So this is the structure of molten globule. Once molten globule forms, it can further fold and gives rise to complete folded protein, right? Now, as we had seen, we have two different models. One is the hierarchical model and second one is the molten globule model. Now the question arises that generally protein folds by which model? So it is seen that most proteins fold by incorporating both the processes. So now coming to the next topic, that is the chaperones. What are chaperones? What is their function? So chaperones are auxiliary proteins which assist protein folding. So here two things are there. Their main function is the protein folding. They helps in the protein folding. In the first point, we had seen that protein folding is not random, but guided one. And these guiding molecules are the chaperones. Chaperone helps other protein in protein folding. And themselves, these chaperones themselves are also a protein. Okay. They are located inside the endoplasmic reticulum. So we can say that protein folding occurs inside endoplasmic reticulum. Now, along with helping other proteins in folding, they also detect misfolded proteins and retain them in endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, so in this way, chaperones also act as a quality control, right? If some proteins are misfolded, if the some protein's quality is not proper, then this chaperone can also detect such misfolded protein and retain them in the endoplasmic reticulum. And later on, this misfolded protein are disposed of by endoplasmic reticulum associated degradation system, that is IRAD system. I will discuss about the IRAD system in my future video. Okay, so basically chaperones have two functions. One function is the help in protein folding and second function is help in disposing of the misfolded protein. Now one interesting observation is that whenever cell experience increased temperature, it leads to increased chaperones inside the cell. Now, this is very beautifully designed physiological system, right? We know that if there is an increased temperature, there is a more occurrence of misfolded protein, right? So, to tackle this situation, our body, our cell synthesize more of the chaperones, okay? So, it can tackle up this situation. So, because of this chaperones response to such high level of heat, they are also called as heat shock proteins, okay? They act as a shock absorbent for a heat, for increased temperature. Now, in our cell, there are two types of chaperones seen. One is HSP70 system and other one is the chaperonin system. Let's discuss one by one. First discuss about HSP70 system. In eukaryotes, this HSP70 system, it is made up of three different protein. One is HSP70, second one is HSP40, and third one is the NEF. The full form of NEF is the nucleotide exchange factor, right? Now, we also know the full form of HSP, that is heat shock protein. Now, you might be wondering, what are these numbers? See, in HSP70, it is heat shock protein having a molecular weight of 70 kilodalton. This HSP40, that means heat shock protein having a molecular weight of 40 kilodalton. And I already told you full form of NEF, that is nucleotide exchange factor. Similar HSP70 system, it is also seen in the prokaryotes. Inside the prokaryotes also, this system is made up of three different protein. The first protein is DNA K, second protein is DNA J, and third protein is GRPE. Now, this DNA K, it is homologous to this eukaryotic HSP70. DNA J is homologous to HSP40, and GRPE is homologous to this nucleotide exchange factor. You might be wondering that why this DNA designation is given to these two protein. The answer I had already written over here is that DNA K and DNA J both are protein, okay? So, when this both protein were first identified as a proteins required for in vitro replication of some viral DNA, their first discovery of this protein was not for these chaperones, but they were first discovered as a requirement for in vitro replication of some viral DNA. And because of this initial discovery, they were given designation of DNA in their name. Okay, so now we understand the naming of these two. What is the meaning of this GRP? That means it's a glucose regulated protein. This particular protein, it is regulated by the glucose. So, it is called as GRPE. This name was given. Now, let's discuss about the second system, second chaperone system, which is known as chaperonin system. Here also, in eukaryotes, it is made up of two proteins. It is HSP60 and HSP10. This is heat shock protein having a molecular weight of 60 kilodalton and heat shock protein having a molecular weight of 10 kilodalton. This chaperonin system, it is also found in the prokaryotes also. And in the prokaryotes, it's a GRO-EL and GRO-ES. This GRO-EL, it is homologous to this eukaryotic HSP60 and GRO-ES, it is homologous to eukaryotic HSP10. Now again, why such name is given? See, GRO-EL and GRO-ES were first identified as a growth requirement in bacteria. And from this growth, this GRO was taken for the naming of this protein. Okay, now how actually this both system works, this HSP70 system and chaperonin system works, that mechanism of action I will cover into immediate next video. Along with this two system, we have two more enzymes also which can act or which can help in the protein folding. So, enzymes in protein folding, we have two different enzymes which help in the protein folding. First is protein disulfide isomerase, and the short form is PDI, and the second one is peptidyl prolyl cis trans isomerase, and its short form is PPI. Now, protein disulfide isomerase, as its name suggests, this is a disulfide isomerase. That means it can make as well as break disulfide bond. See, this is surprising. The same enzyme, it makes disulfide bond and it also breaks disulfide bond, and both of these work are totally opposite to each other. Now, this PDI, it interchange or shuffles disulfide bond. Why? Because it can make and break disulfide bond. So, it keeps interchanging and shuffling of disulfide bonds until the bonds of native conformations are formed. and in this way it helps in the protein folding. Let's discuss about the second enzyme, that is peptidyl prolyl cis trans isomerase, and its short form is PPI. Now, as the name suggests, it acts on this peptidyl prolyl. So here X means it can be any amino acid. This is peptide bond and this is prolyl. So this is peptidyl prolyl type of peptide bond. Now this enzyme will act only on those peptide bond where proline occurs as a second amino acid. The first amino acid can be any. So what happens when protein is newly synthesized? All of these peptide bonds are in the trans configuration. So trans configuration in newly synthesized peptide bond. In any peptide bond, it can be this peptidyl prolyl peptide bond or it can be any other peptide bond. All are in the trans configuration when it is newly synthesized. But this particular peptide bond, it is converted by this enzyme, by this PPI, to the cis configuration. Okay, so here this X pro peptide bond, it is converted to cis configuration by this PPI bond. Now this PPI is a slowly acting enzyme. So it is not able to convert all of this X pro bond into this cis configuration. So here I had written not that approximately 10% of X pro peptide bonds are converted to cis configuration. Okay, so this is how this both enzyme will help in the protein folding. So that's all about the protein folding. If you have any query or confusion, please write it down in the comment section below. Thank you.